We're back, and this little segment, we want to talk about the importance of the tools, the cameras, what it takes to make the image. And through Ed's career, he's moved from film, analog, if we call it that these days, into the digital realm. And he's got a great story in regards to that, but I think one of the things that's most important to realize is that early on, the image quality was of utmost importance. And as you heard in the previous segment, he did a lot with view cameras and 4x5 film to capture the minute detail of some of the subjects, you know, that he was capturing when he was back doing his nature side of things. And that continued along the way, and you worked from 4x5 to 8x10 somewhere along the way, until finally where we are today digitally. So I'm gonna let Ed talk a little bit about the importance of image quality, how it's played the importance, and the transition from when you started with film to where you are with your tools today in the digital world, and when it was that you made that decision that digital was here.
Right. Well, I always had a fascination with one of the qualities of photography that it had that, for instance, painting didn't have. And when I was younger, I grew up painting with my father, with oils on the back of Masonite. And then when I was 11, I got my first 35mm camera and went out shooting black and white film with it. And I shot largely black and white for the first 10 years of my life. But as soon as I decided I wanted to get more serious about photography, I left my hometown, St. Catharines, and moved to Toronto and went to the university that I graduated from, Ryerson, and took a photography program that gave me a Bachelor of Arts, which was considered the best at that time and still is considered one of the best in the country. And the minute I got there, the first thing I did is I bought a 2¼. I ended up buying a Mamiya 2¼ camera, 645. And I ran around with that a lot. And then one of my instructors introduced me to the 4x5 through an assignment. And I started shooting with a 4x5. And I loved the process of it. And I loved the quality of the images that I got. So right out of the gate, I was always interested in the print and making these incredible prints and what the experience of that kind of detail and resolution and tonality that a print can give you that can really make you experience a piece of our world. And what was interesting to me was to take something that may not normally be thought of as subject matter for an image, and using a high resolution tool, have it transcend into another kind of space where you're looking at a piece of our world, but yet it seems to transport you into another world, a world of wonder or of aesthetic, where you're kind of trying to make sense of where this is in the world and why did the artist, you know, take a picture of that, but yet at the same time be drawn to the image. And so as I worked through, I worked with, you know, 4x5, but then I discovered color and started working with color, I think around 1980, 81. And once I turned to color from black and white, I never kind of turned back. I just kept doing color.
So you just went to color.
I went to color. And at the time, I mean, there were a few color artists working at the time. Stephen Shore, Elliot Porter had done a series of color of the landscape. And there was a handful. Joel Meyerowitz was working at the time. I thought, you know, this is pretty interesting. You know, not very many are engaged in color and art and the large format image. And I thought I could really start pioneering my own way through all of this technology and through the new materials. So I started doing and working with 4x5. Eventually I progressed to 4x5 and 8x10 in 1990 when I was doing the quarries. I thought, hey, it might be really interesting to take the next jump and go, and I borrowed an 8x10 with all the lenses and started shooting 8x10 and then fell in love with that. One more leap of difficulty in when you start working with 8x10, but I again appreciated that slowing down, that difficulty, that kind of mastering of a technology like that, and getting it sharp, perfect exposure, great light. It really takes a long time. Sometimes I'd spend 2 days setting up and waiting for the light for one 8x10 image.
That's incredible. I love it when you do that. Now, were you doing negative or transparency film?
All negative.
All negative.
Yeah, I did a whole trip where I did one holder negative and one holder transparency, and I did cibachromes and prints just to make sure where I wanted to go. And two things happened. One is I recognized how limiting transparency was. In other words, if you shoot within a 3 to 4 stop range, it works great. And it's pretty nice, but then you go into a cibachrome and it was very poppy. It was just like so super saturated. And then when you did with the negative, same scenes, printed on the paper at that time, and it just seemed more, to me,
more control of,
more control, more natural color than what transparency had. So I then said, okay, no, I'm going negative all the way. And I never looked back. I just did everything in negative at that point. So then when I started shooting 8x10, I already had the lab, so it allowed me to really control the 8x10 processing. I had my own processor, and I had my own printing machines, and I had my own 8x10 enlarger, so I can enlarge, you know, up to, at that time, I was doing 40x50s. In 1992, I opened up a digital lab teaching Photoshop, and you know the digital cameras were pretty rudimentary back then, you know, 10 megapixels, 7 megapixel. I remember Kodak had, I think, a refitted Nikon and with a back on it. I think it was 7 megapixel and it cost $50,000 or something.
It's
went, oh, this is the future. A little expensive right now.
You saw the future.
You recognized it. Yeah, this isn't going to get uninvented. Yeah. This has got a one-way trip. Yeah. I kept working with the tools. And when I started doing the China project in 2003, 4, and 5, I was shooting, and China is very hazy. And so I'd come back with my negatives, and they'd be like, I'd print them, and they'd be really flat. And I'm thinking, well, what can I do? So then I started scanning them, getting the color correction that I wanted, and then putting them back into a negative. And
so
then
you went to a hybrid digital solution at that time.
At that time,
there was no printing capability, so you rewrote a new negative.
Right. You rewrote a new negative, and then with that negative, I'd go back in the enlarger and blow it up. And I worked that way for a while, and then some technology started to come into play, the light jet, the Durst Lambda, and the Chimera. So then, just around 2005, I ended up buying the Chimera, which is a ZBE company that I can write directly onto photo paper. And so I started doing those China images directly to photo paper, that instead of going to the inter-negative stage. And I did that for a while, but then I also started to try to do aerial work. And the problem with taking a 4x5 up into, number one, you can't let the holder go. It might go into the back rotor, and then we're all going down to our deaths. And so the pilots are always afraid of me with holders and all that stuff just out by the door, because it's very dangerous. Secondly, it's very cumbersome. And thirdly, these large format lenses aren't very fast. They don't work very well wide open. So I was running into all these problems. So then I decided to rent a Hasselblad. I rented one with a 40 megapixel back and shot it side by side with the 4x5 and realized that the results were amazing. They were much better than my 4x5 results. So that was the first time I went into a digital camera, even though I had a digital lab at that point for 12 years. I still shot film because it was better.
So now you're into digital capture. You've hit that point where you think it's good enough.
It's good enough for aerial, although I still balanced for about 3 years. I did half, like stuff I did on the ground with architecture, I still did with my 4x5, 8x10, because I still did architectural city stuff. And then all my aerial work I was doing with digital. And then Hasselblad started moving into the 50 and 60 megapixel cameras. Then I started shooting more and more with that camera, and it had the tilt shift, and I started adding more and more things to it. I'd say by 2010, I had fully transformed to digital.
And you were working with a Hasselblad H system like this. This is the new one, the 100 megapixels. We'll come and talk about that in a second.
It's 100, but so it started with the 40, then I ended up owning the 50, then I owned the 60, and now this is 100 that's going on my next trip. So the jump from the 60 to the 100 I'm very excited about, because it's like another 67% or something of data And the 60 was giving me some pretty incredible results.
Yeah, we have some images back here, and in another segment, we're going to be looking at some of the prints and, you know, talking about the whole print side of things. But you finally got to a point where you were getting the resolution. And if you equated that resolution off to analog, how would you numerically say where, you know, which where the jumps were, like the 4x5 and further, yeah, well, and where we are today?
So when I did that side-by-side test out of the helicopter with my 4x5 and the 40 megapixel, I'd say the 40 was actually performing as well in terms of color saturation and grain, but the 4x5 was giving me trouble in the corners of softness, mm-hmm. because I had to shoot almost wide open. Whereas the wide-angle lens on the Hasselblad, wide open, was still sharp corner to corner. So if overall response was actually giving me better results than my 4x5 at that time. That was why I jumped over. It was through the fact that it was doing something better than the way than any solution I had in the analog world. And that was my first step. And then once I got into the 60 megapixel, it felt like I, you know, it was better than the 4x5, but not quite 8x10. So I'd put it like in a 5x7.
Incremental movement.
A 5x7 format. Yeah. And now with this 100, I'm assuming, and I haven't worked with it enough, but I'm assuming it's going to put me into back to the old 8x10 days, that the quality I'm going to get is as if I was standing in front of an 8x10 print from an 8x10 make.
You know, having used 100 megapixel, I want to hear what you think when you're finished with it, because it truly is not just an incremental step. I think you'll find that, you know, you'll see things that you just never thought you could see before. You're in for a great
adventure.
I'm very excited. So now your typical setup, you take a Hasselblad system on the road. Is it many cases, or do you try to travel with X number of lenses? What's your shooting setup all about?
Well, I have about 5 lenses I usually take, and then I also have the gyro stabilizer, because I do a lot of work from aerial perspectives, and so I'm pointing the camera, out of the open door of a helicopter or out of the open window of a Cessna. So you need to stabilize the camera so you don't get as much shake in it, and that does a pretty good job. With doing that, it does make the whole thing quite heavy. So a couple hours up in the air, and you come down, your arms are beat. But that's all right. That's part of the process. I don't complain, because I've read the kind of stories of Carlton Watkins and the mammoth plates, and thinking that this is still pretty easy.
You don't need a mule and a mule train to take all your stuff.
That's
to the
right,
top
and,
of
and cut the road to bring it through. You know, so this is. You know, I don't complain about those kinds of things, given knowing the history of photography. But the toolkit is usually about two or three bags. And so I have, and I also now start working with film crews, and so I'm bringing the Red Epic and other.
So you're
cameras.
Doing a video documentary at the same time.
Yeah,
so I've seen one or two of those. They're really remarkable. Was it the Watermark Project?
Watermark Project.
Yeah, it was pretty nice.
Yeah, if I've got the whole film crew coming, there's usually a crew of 6 or 7 of us, 20-25 cases with all kinds of different tools.
Have you found a lens that's your favorite? I mean, do you prefer wide angle? Do you like the compression that a longer lens gives you? How do you select the lens, or do you try to fit the image into your favorite lens, or do you use a lens that works for the subject?
When I'm working in the helicopter or in the plane, I've found the slightly wide-angle lens works. I've tried. It's interesting that I even did tests where I took a normal lens in a helicopter and backed away to get to fill the same frame, and took a picture with a normal lens, or got closer with the 50. And I prefer the way the 50 reacts.
It offers a nice perspective.
It opens up the landscape in a different way. There are a series of aerial lenses that have no focus ability, so they're set at infinity. And when you're up there, sometimes the last thing you want is to deal with focus, because you can hit if it's autofocus, you don't want to use it, you can hit water and all of a sudden it's going all over the place because it can't grab onto anything. Eliminating focus, because I'm always more than 100 feet away if I'm aerial, or 200 feet away, so it's not a problem.
So you can almost shoot wide open too.
I do shoot wide open, a lot, and because I like to shoot when the light is in full sun and lots of contrasts and lots of shadows, I love the softer light, often comes later in the day. So I'm always pushing up against ASA, shutter speed, and wide open all the time. So to me, those are the real challenges.
Well, with the new Hasselblad backs and the CMOS technology, how do you find working with higher ISOs? Are you able to work at a higher ISO, set your shutter speed higher, and accomplish more? Or?
Well, CMOS, I understand, is, and I haven't worked a lot with it, I've been, because the 60 megapixels is still CCD, right. And it didn't like going past even 100. 100 was where I'd stop. 200, you'd start seeing it. 400, you really see it a lot. Whereas CMOS, you can go into higher ISOs and still not get as much grain in it.
Come back to us on that one. I think you're in for a pleasant surprise.
Good.
This device I always find amazing. If you've never used, this is the Kenyon, correct? Yes.
Yep.
If you've never used a gyro, you can rent these. You can go online and find them. But once it starts up and cycles, and you put the camera on, it truly is like almost like
it's like fighting a live beast.
You can't describe it, and it's hard to imagine that a device can do that. But it really does add a lot of stabilization. I mean, if you can get it to where you want it, and like you said, it's a heavy device, and at the same time, it's almost fighting you. But remarkable for adding that maybe one or two stops at least.
If I've got everything working well, I've been down to 125th of a second, 1/125th, and getting results with it. I'd have to multiple shoot it because not everyone's going to get it, but I can still pull it off once in a while at that shutter speed in the air. But what I was trying to always do is to, whether it's in a drone or whether it's out of a helicopter or whether it's out of a fixed-wing airplane, my ambition was it's as if I had the camera on a tripod. And squeezing off a shot on my 4x5. So that's, so even though I'm bouncing around a helicopter and it's crazy and you're getting buffeted by winds and you've got, the blade, blow down and all of that happening, that at the end of the day, it still looks like you're on a tripod and squeezing it off with a shutter cable release.
Do you take multiple cameras and bodies up with you? Obviously, you don't want to change lenses while you're up in the air, or do you decide on just one lens and one body?
Just one lens.
One body.
One body, one lens.
Simplify your life.
No, I do. It's absolutely. Like I did one where I went up to do a mine, the Bingham Valley. It was a Kennecott copper mine. And I opened the door 15 or 20 below. And you have the wash of the blade coming down. So I don't know what that does to the temperature.
But there's a wind chill.
Yeah, there's a wind chill. I don't know what it was. I had my gloves. I think I got about 10 minutes out of the blad before it was just way too cold. So it just stopped. And I would imagine that any camera at that time, because at those brutal kind of temperatures.
How did you fare?
Well, I was cold, but not every frame is going to be sharp because you're up against a lot of different forces. And so when I get close to what I think is my shot, then I'll slow, if I can, like a helicopter, I'll slow it down to the point where I can squeeze off four or five, because there's usually one that just comes in crisp and the other ones aren't as crisp. So it's not an easy thing to do at all.
No, it can't be. Now, most of your work, as you look at all your body of work, is from, high angle to a very high angle, straight down almost sometimes. And you've shot a lot from, as you say, airplanes and helicopters. But, today we have drones. So, where's the drone fitting into your aerial photography aspect of things these days?
Well, I still use them, but the limit to a drone is about 1,000 feet of elevation. The first one was a single blade, and now I'm using the multiple blades, octocopters or the six-bladed ones, and putting this on it. And the one I'm going to Chile. And I think the lift that I have on the one, because we're starting at about 8,000 feet of elevation, and then we want to go up another 1,000 or two. So for every 1,000 feet, I think you lose a pound of lift. The drone that we have now has a lifting capacity of 100 pounds. So
a drone with 100-pound lifting, that's pretty incredible.
Yeah, so we can take this and deal with the atmosphere and still get it up maybe 1,500 feet and shoot down with it, because what we're trying to shoot has needs that kind of elevation. So we need about 9,500
feet. You're not flying the drone. You probably have an operator flying the drone, but you must have a device which you're controlling the gimbal and the camera, correct?
Yeah, so I'm just controlling the whole gimbal, and so I can do, you know, pan, tilt, roll, and it's just like having a tripod, so I compose, and I hit the shutter as well. And I've got a video signal coming back to my, so I'm seeing exactly what the camera's seeing. And I actually have a GoPro sitting on top, and I send the signal back to my controller.
Do you go above 1,000 feet a lot, or do you have a magic altitude that you tend to work with that gives you a nice angle?
With a drone, it's hard to go past 1,000 feet up, because it's hard to see it after that. It just becomes a small dot, and you get less control of it. I used to have rules of thumb, like I tried not to get too far past 1,000 feet, because I always wanted in the viewing of the print to actually identify, oh, that's a truck, or there's a person standing over there. But if the subject matter calls for it now to go further back, I will go further back. So I do let the subject matter determine, you know, where I should stand for, or where I should be.
I guess because some of your areas are so immense, you either got to get way high up, or, you know, be at a far enough distance with a lens that can get you.
Yep.
You know, all that.
Yep.
So anyway, Hasselblad's your tool of choice these days, and you're like the 40mm, 50mm lens is probably somewhere in your...
Yeah, the 50 is great with the aerial lens. The other thing, I think the firmware, if I'm not mistaken, some of that color management was brought over from the Imicon system in terms of color, and it really did mirror the results I used to get from negative. And way back when, and I test everything, and way back when I tried, you know, with the phase and the capture system, it felt more like chrome to me. Mm-hmm. It felt more commercial. Whereas this, to me, it worked in a kind of that negative, that softer print result. So I, as an artist, I was interested in the print. And so I was able to get the kinds of color and be in that color space much more easily with the Hasselblad in the making of prints.
Very cool. Well, this has been pretty fascinating. I mean, you know, we all love our gear, but just to see what you do with it. We have two more segments where you're going to come into. We're going to talk about the print side of things and how you store your prints and what you do, because the prints are so important. And we spent a lot of time on Luminous Landscape talking about getting back to the print, because, you know, we're into such a kind of a swiping society. And then the last aspect of things, we want to take a look at the tour. The fact that you control the whole process is a lot different than a lot of, you know, photographers are doing this day. And, you know, not only are you working with, you know, with digital printers, but you're also working with, you know, chemical-based digital imaging at the same time. So I look forward to getting into the back part of the building later on and taking a look at that. So
fabulous.
This has been great. There's a lot of books where a lot of the things we talked about during the interview, you'll find links in the text part of this article. So that if you want to take a look at some of the other photographers mentioned or some of the gear mentioned, you'll be able to find information about that. We'll also put in links to Ed's books that are available and certain aspects of his site, so you can kind of go in there and take a look at some of the things we've talked about as far as your history and, you know, some of the projects like the Watermark Project and things like that. So
great.
We'll see you guys back in a little while. And thanks, Ed.
Thanks, Kevin.
Really pretty amazing, and we'll be back. Here.